the final presentation for today is from Chris Adoulos, who's been doing a PhD with Andrew. So if you want to load up your slides.
Can you see me?
No, we'll have to. Can you see it? Oh, sorry.
Okay. Yes.
No, I can't see it yet.
No. Can you hear?
You have to switch share screen on, Chris.
Yes.
And you can switch your camera on too if you like.
Share content. Okay. I think it's okay now. Yes.
Yeah, that's good. Just hit the presenter view. That's it.
Thank you.
Okay, go for it.
Can I start? Yes.
Yes.
So, as you can see, I named my presentation and my PhD Principles of Organization Within the Pathways in the Brainstem and Thalamus, because there are specific and well-established principles that characterize the organization of the pathways in the brain. I did a similar talk last year at UNSW, and a member of the committee, of the panel review committee, told me, Chris, you have to say in five words what you did during your PhD. And I replied, I will say in three words. I subdivided the pyramidal tract. As you can see here, this is a mainstream MRI. This is my actual MRI. You can see my cortex here. This is the brainstem and the thalamus. This is the region that I have been studying for the last 3 years. I have been studying. As you can see, there is the spinal cord, and we know from histology and various methods that we have identified the layers of the neocortex. But there is an area here within the pons, the basilar pons, that constituted an uncharted territory. And here you can see the volumetric set of data that we have from Duke University. This is the highest resolution ever achieved for an MRI project. And you can see the thalamus at the top, the midbrain, the pons, the inferior olivary nucleus, and the medulla oblongata. So why should we undertake this study? This is an anatomical, a pure anatomical study for better knowledge of brainstem pathways, because we are going to be able to have a more precise neurosurgery for radiotherapeutic interventions, and we are going to shed light on basic neuroscience. This is the director of the Duke Center for In Vivo Microscopy, Professor Al Johnson. They managed to create the highest resolution data ever achieved, because the engineers they managed to form and to create a novel MRI machine. This is the actual scanner. They dismantled everything, and they created a small animal MRI scanner, which is 7 Tesla. And our aim is to produce state-of-the-art images to map and to promote brain mapping in its natural 3D space, and to discover new pathways or even new nuclei. And this is a coronal view of the brainstem and thalamus that we have. You can see how beautiful the 5N, the trigeminal nerve, enters the brainstem. These are the transverse fibers of the pons in red. And all this is the internal capsule, and the pyramidal tract, as you can see, it leaves a signature in bluish. Our resources, all our specimens are ex vivo, taken from autopsy. So we managed to achieve 50 micron of anatomical data, GRE, gradient recalled echo, and 200 microns of FAC, which is the fractional anisotropic color, and the other as well, in addition, the DDI scalars. We also have two human brain stems from Johns Hopkins University, and one macaque brainstem, which is 25 microns of resolution. And this is a 65-year-old man who died while he was playing golf in America, and we took his brain and we managed to see all these pathways. These are the descending fiber bundles and the transverse fiber bundles in red from the thalamus until the spinal cord. These are the pyramids, and the bundles converge to form the cervical, thoracic, and lumbar and sacral pyramidal tracts. The decussation, as you just saw, in bluish. So in the first chapter of my thesis, I analyzed the motor pathways. Why? Because the basilar pons, as you can see here, constituted an uncharted territory until now, and it has major clinical applications, particularly for tumors in the basilar pons. And historically, for another reason, is three men, Bouchard, Charcot, and Fleshin, made accurate descriptions of the corticospinal tract. This is the guy who discovered and anatomically described the basilar pons, Constanzo Varolio. He was an Italian anatomist and papal physician. In the second chapter, we analyze the pain pathways. Why? Because also here there is clinical importance. We tried and we did, we established anatomical landmarks between these tracts. I thank Professor Ashwell. It was his idea for me to study the sensory pathways, and it has also an important feedback control for output for motor control, because the neocortex always has to receive feedback from the periphery in order to adjust the neuron firing frequency. Also, René Descartes, a European thinker, understood in the Renaissance that there was connections between the periphery and the brain. In the third chapter, we analyze the human dentator umbrothalamic tract. Why? Because it closes the loop of the cerebrocerebellar circuit, which is a control between the pyramidal and extrapyramidal systems, and it has clinical application, particularly in essential tremor. As you see here, it was well known that there was a dentator umbrothalamic tract, but we didn't have the actual anatomy pathway. The pyramid about extrapyramidal systems, everything that is not pyramidal, as my Italian mentors used to say, is extrapyramidal, such as the rubrospinal, the vestibulospinal, the tectospinal, and the reticulospinal. And on this neuron firing frequency, it comes the pyramidal control, which adjusts its inhibitory on interneurons and adjusts the neuron firing frequency for the refinement of movement. So this is the notion that we had about the basilar pons and the descending fibers, fiber bundles that include the corticopontine, corticospinal, corticobulbar, and corticospinal tracts. And they thought that it was within the central nucleus, whereas the basilar pons maintained its subdivisions according to Nyby, 1951. And this is the reality from Duke University. We have managed to identify 9 descending fiber bundles, 3 groups, the ventral group, the intermediate, and the dorsal, which constitutes respectively the cervical, the thoracic, and the lumbar and sacral components of the pyramidal tract. We have also identified 10 transverse fiber bundles and a novel pathway at the midline of the pons, which I named as the stria pons. And then we trace the fiber bundles rostrally between rhombomere 2 and rhombomere 1 in the pons midbrain junction, and where the leader lines point is the precise location where the fiber bundles project. and these are this is the nomenclature according to anatomical cardinal directions. Also in transverse sections, because we only now have the possibility to see the brainstem in its natural 3D space, you can see that these fiber bundles were like sheets, like ropes, and it was not as it was. The reality is not as it was considered a melange in the past. And also the transverse fibers of the pons in red alternate the descending fiber bundles. And these are our specimens. We also have two more from Johns Hopkins University, and in panel F we have also the macaque brain, where we found that the descending fiber bundles are only 4 and 10 transverse fiber bundles. This reflects the ability, the dexterity that humans acquired throughout evolution. And here we are at the level of the midpons. In blue, you can see again the descending fiber bundles. In red, the transverse. We have subdivided. There are some differences and instability between the fibers, between the left and the right side, which is anatomy. And but we found, for example, that the fibers are 9 on one side, or they can be 10 on the other side, etc. It's not that we found 9 on one side or 20 on the other side. There is, these are highly maintained. And the fiber bundles converge at the level of the pyramids to form the cervical, the thoracic, the lumbar, and sacral pyramidal tracts. As you can see here in all the specimens, you can actually see how they get compacted here, and it changes the contrast of the DTI changes. So we traced 9 discrete descending fiber bundles, which are consistent between humans, maintaining a degree of variability. The human fiber bundles are more complex than the macaque ones. We have also traced and anatomically described 10 transverse fibers of the pons, which are all functionally connected to the descending ones. For example, the ventral group of the descending corresponds and sends information to the ventral group of the pontine nuclei, and then from there, from the pontine nuclei, the transverse fibers of the pons form to send the projections to the cerebellum. We have also discovered a novel pathway at the midline of the pons. I named it as the stria pontis. We knew from electrophysiological studies that there were projections to the nuclei of the cranial nerves, as in this cartoon published in Neuroanatomy, Frontiers in Neuroanatomy in 2018, but we didn't know where and how these fibers project. Only now we know what's happening. So this pontis, we identified at the level of the motor trigeminal nucleus. Here is the motor trigeminal nucleus, and the stria pontis projects towards this nucleus. At the more caudal level, we found that the stria pontis also veers in front of the foreventricle laterally to project into the tegmentum, and here is the sixth end, the sixth cranial nerve nucleus. With these images, which are ultra high resolution images, and I managed to create these images with a specific program analyzing the diffusion MRI, we can see the primary first eigenvector within each voxel, and we found that the fibers originate from each of the transverse fibers of the pons. So this is a major finding, and then the fibers bend to form the stria pontis at the midline of the pons towards the tegmentum. So the stria pontis is a novel pathway. It's part of the corticotegmental pathway. Why? Because we found the ending of this pathway, and we found that these fibers that form the stria pontis emanate from the transverse fibers of the pons. And it has a major implication for cranial nerve outputs. So tractography is a 3D modeling technique used to visualize tracts on diffusion MRI. After you put a seed region, you can test where these tracts and how and where they project. It's a very complex method. You have to understand linear algebra and you have to experiment a lot because the drawbacks are amazingly high that you are going to have, especially by doing this method on high resolution data. So during my first year, I was experimenting and I was putting different masks, and it was only a disaster what I did. And then I trained myself and I optimized my technique. Here you can see the last tractographic analysis I did. These are the mammillary bodies, and you see the mammillotegmental tract, how it projects directly to the ventral tegmental nucleus. And they tried also at Harvard University, but they failed. They created this DTI, which was not anatomically informative, and they didn't manage to show any fiber patterning or any discovery. So they were subdivided in rows. You can see different levels. In columns, you can see, in rows, you can see different subdivisions. In columns, you can see different levels from the internal capsule until here into the pyramid. So I subdivided the pyramidal tract in four bundles, in three bundles. The cervical, as you see here, the thoracic, which occupies an intermediate position, and the lumbar and sacral according to the long axis of the internal capsule. Then I found a long sliver here, which is occupied by the projections to the substantia nigra pars reticulata. You can see it here that the pars compacta remains vacant of fibers. And at different levels of the brain, the cervical occupies the external position, the intermediate by the thoracic, and the internal position, as it slices through the substantia nigra, is the lumbar and sacral. Pons midbrain junction, the fibers twist ventrally to form the cervical, thoracic, and lumbar and sacral dorsally. It maintains the same patterning throughout the pons, whereas it twists medially the cervical to form this bundle here, which is the cervical, the ventral part of the fibers that occupy the ventral pons, the thoracic intermediate, and the lumbar and sacral here. So there is a topographical alignment of these descending fiber bundles from the internal capsule to the spinal cord, and we managed to create a similar architectural model to that of the circle of Willis. So if you have a patient with a tumor in the pons, you can actually predict and burn this tumor with minimal damage to adjacent bundles using these subdivisions that we created. In the second chapter of my thesis, we analyzed the ascending sensory pathways. I create these tracts, the spinothalamic, which is a novelty. Nobody has identified the exact position of the spinothalamic tract, the medial lemniscus, the various decussations. Here is the trigeminal nerve and the ventral and dorsal trigeminothalamic tracts as they project towards the ventral posteromedial nucleus of the thalamus. The medial lemniscus, as you can see here, this was the notion that we had about the ML, only a vertical bundle. Nobody talked about decussations or any other particular anatomy until this. Here, the ML converged with the spinothalamic towards the thalamus, where they converge to into the same nucleus, the ventral posterolateral. So the human dentate or umbrothalamic tract in the third chapter, it has major clinical application for essential tremor. As you can see, also we managed to identify the fornix here, the mammillotegmental tract, the mammillothalamic tract, and the various nuclei. This is the notion of the dentator ubrothalamic. It was not very informative during this article published in 2016, and there is no anatomical description. So we identified 90s fiber bundles of the between humans with a degree of variability. They are more complex with a higher number of interdigitations against the macaque, vs the macaque. We established anatomical landmarks between the sensory, the pain pathways, and this is the first study on the that shows the relationship between these pathways. We identified the dentator ubrothalamic tract in 3D, and we identified 97 anatomical structures already known in its natural 3D space. I would like to thank my co-supervisor, Professor Ken Ashwell. He was beside me on a daily basis throughout my experience and my studies. He taught me comparative anatomy and showed me how to make atlases. My sincere thanks to Professor Wen, who taught me tractography basically, and he taught me computer science and computer language. My deepest gratitude to my collaborator, Professor Manisha Agrawal at Johns Hopkins. I hope for a long-term collaboration. Of course, I would like to thank my Professor Paxinos. He was for 20 years my mentor. He brought me here, and I will be always grateful to him. I hope for a collaboration in the future. And this is my current supervisor, and we established a wonderful professional academic relationship. I hope for a long-term collaboration. Maybe we are going to study the stria pontis and the fibers using electrophysiological methods in the future. We will see how we are going to proceed.
Okay, thank you very much. Great talk. Okay, open it up for questions. Richard Vickery had his hand up first.
Fastest gun in the West. Nice talk, Christos.
Thank you.
So that was all diffusion tensor imaging. What's the sort of shortest length of tract that you can visualize with that?
You mean with the tensor, with my tensor glyphs? It's very short. It's one voxel, as you could see on the material pictures that I had. It's very short.
And are you able to do some sort of volumetric analysis, or maybe in the future would it be possible to tell whether those lateral branches into the pons are collaterals or their own axons by looking at the change in volume above and below where they branch off? Is that possible now or in the future?
You mean the collaterals, the fibers that form the fibers from the transverse fibers?
Yes.
We cannot identify if these are collaterals or one neuron that comes from the cortex, because DTI and tractography, also the tensor glyphs, doesn't show synapses. They show just the pathway, because it's based on the laws of fractional anisotropy.
Sure. But what about if you look at the cross-sectional areas above and below? Can you do some kind of calculation that way?
What do you mean about and below?
Well, you can imagine you have a diameter like this, and yes, then if it's smaller below, then you've got less axons. So they're not all propagating onwards.
Yes, you see the pathway, and this is the deepest, as we can see. Maybe in the future, if the scanners are more powerful and they manage to produce a resolution which approaches that of histology, maybe we are going to see better, of course. But I repeat, you do not see synapses. You see the pathway, because the water molecules align alongside the axons. Yeah.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, Pascal, you've got a question?
Yes, I have a question. Yes. Hi, Chris. Beautiful pictures and actually quite a lot of work that you've done here. So I have two questions. Probably the first one is about the somatotopy that you find in those descending bundles in the corticospinal.
Yes.
So how certain are you that this somatotopy is actually correct, that the one you proposed here?
Yes.
Have you been able to really trace these fibers?
Yes, yes. Yes, first of all, the ventral and the intermediate and the dorsal subdivisions of the main groups of the first of the primary subdivisions in the within the basilar pons corresponds to the cervical, thoracic, and lumbar and sacral as the bulk of the studies showed, also with previous in the literature, also with biological tracers, first of all, with other tractographic analysis, secondly, and also with degenerated fibers in people who had strokes, for example. Secondly, I traced every single fiber bundle with DTI and the anatomical images, and these fibers, while they approach the pyramids, they twist. I actually saw, and I report the images in my thesis, they twist to form the cervical, which is found medially in the pyramid, the thoracic, the intermediate part of the pyramid, and the lumbar and sacral, which is the lateral part of the pyramids. This also corresponds to what is known until now. It corresponds with other anatomical studies. So, and the same I did, I traced the fiber bundles, and I always validated my results with the actual GRE and the anatomical images, and the other DTI contrasts.
So you validated that in one brain only?
No, in four brains and one macaque.
Four brains, four human brains and one macaque.
Yeah, four human brains and one macaque.
Okay.
Which we have a somatotopy within the basilar pons, which was already known. We knew that the ventral part was the cervical within the basilar pons. We knew that the intermediate part was the thoracic, and the lumbar and sacral, the dorsal part, but now we have the actual topography, the mapping of the descending fiber bundles, the characterization, the anatomical description, and yes.
I have another question, and that's related to this triapontis.
Yes.
So these are quite extraordinary fibers because they are leaving the bundle, the main bundle, and then they're traveling on the midline upwards towards the ventricle. They reach the ventricle, and then they turn laterally to reach the cranial motor nuclei.
Yes, exactly.
How do you explain this weird path?
For me, after I studied this for 3 years, I concluded that it's an architectural model which is symmetrical, because you have the descending fiber bundles, the nine, you have the 10 transverse fiber bundles that alternate one after the other in sequence. And so every other major pathway that had to be formed during evolution had to go through the midline, which also evolutionary corresponds to the medullary stria. It's normal, it's logical that there should be a pathway there, because we know that there is a similar, not the same, I'm correct, I am very precise on what I'm saying, a similar pathway in the medulla oblongata. We knew about the medullary stria, which also evolutionary and also in comparative anatomy, there has to be also something there.
So the and that's my last question, Nigel. So the ipsilateral projection then, because some of these fibers are going on the ipsilateral side, then and not only on the contralateral side.
There have been found also contralateral projections to the tegmentum with biological traces. Yes.
What is the pathway that they, how do they go there?
They didn't know because they injected the neocortex and they found the terminals, they found the viruses in the tegmentum.
Were these going also through the midline, right, Pontus, or is there another pathway for this ipsilateral projection?
No. There is. They didn't find that it goes. They saw. They injected the cortex, and they found the terminations in the tegmentum.
So we don't know what the path.
As you saw before, I saw the cartoon that we knew about the projections to the tegmentum. It was published 3 years ago, but they only hypothesized how it was going, and they created drawings. We didn't actually know that there is a pathway there where in the future maybe you can put an electrode and maybe you can see experimentally what's going to happen.
He's smiling.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you very much.
Well, that's right on 30 minutes for your slot, Chris. Well done. I'd like to thank all of the speakers from the talks today. Everyone did a fantastic job, and congratulations to you all, and thanks to everyone who contributed to questions, and enjoy your evening and weekend.
Thank you very much.
They will replay that over and over and over to figure out what you did and what you've been doing. Because it's like an answer sheet, the question and answers. So they want to know.